Good morning.
Good morning, good morning. Welcome, everyone, to Williams. Real quick, find someone you have not seen this morning. Smile at them. Go person in front of you and the first person behind you. I always love that. You just can't help but giggle. I love to giggle. All right, hopefully you all have your bulletins ready and open. But first, if you are visiting with us this morning, welcome again. And visitors, if you look to the end of the pew, there's a little form, a little slender sheet of paper like so. It says welcome on it, eggshell color. If you could just fill that out, put it in the offering plate, the golden plate. It will come by in a few minutes. Alrighty, there are a lot of things going on here at Williams, like always. But first, Scotty has to tell you about some stuff going on in the youth departments. Come on up here, Scotty.
Good morning, friends and neighbors. So just a few things coming up real soon. We've got our ice cream social / slip and slide kickball coming up Wednesday at 6. I cannot say that three times fast. I barely said it once. Okay, so Wednesday night at 6:30, come in. We'll do the business meeting. Come out. Let's kick some ball and eat some ice cream. We'll also have cornhole, badminton, some other games set up if you don't feel like breaking your leg or a hip playing slip and slide kickball. Also, if you feel compelled in your heart to lead Sunday school for the youth, I would love to speak with you. Jake and Courtney are doing a great job teaching every other month, but if you feel led to do something in that nature, please see me. I would love to allow you to do that. And also, snack coming up tonight, guys. Meet at the church at 5:45. Bring swimsuits and towels and stuff. Want to thank a few people real quick. I know I'm talking a lot, but I want to thank Lamar and Diane for having us a few Sundays ago. Thank you, guys. And then I also want to thank Wendy and Tyler for having us tonight. And for those of you who've signed up, thank you so much. We are filled up through the summer for people who have agreed to do snack with us. So I'm gracious and very thankful for all of you. And that is all.
Thank you, Scotty. All right, look on with me in the bulletin. One, do it. Oh, snacks. I can't read mouths very well. Bring snacks Wednesday night, along with the ice cream social. Bring some snacky foods. All right, after the service this morning, children, and if you consider yourself a kid, hey, you're invited too. We're going to go eat some pizza, have lunch together, and go see The Secret Life of Pets movie, which looks hilarious. So I'm excited. So just meet me up in the front here, and we'll head on out to the movies. All right. When you leave today in the foyer, hopefully you leave out that exit, you will see this. This piece of art will be out there, and there's some pieces of paper on the board for you to pull off. Yes, you're allowed to pull it off, take it with you, run to Walmart, buy the item, or Lowe's, or wherever you can find it, and get it here by Wednesday. These are items needed for VBS, which will start in a week. So, big, important event coming up. So please help us out with that. And if I could, I would like to meet with any of my volunteers that have a class for VBS. After the service, just come see me really quick. And also tonight, there will be a safety committee meeting at 6 o'clock. So read that information. If you are a part of that group, be there. Now, there's other things going on. Make sure that you read about it. It's in our bulletin. Business meeting on Wednesday. And there's some donations needed. So read about that and on the back as well. I've done enough talking. And I have not done enough hugging. So let's stand up and let's hug some people. Kiss some people on the cheek, shake hands. Go for it.
Hug some people. Hug people. People hugger.
Good morning. It's my mic. There we go. Heyo. I need to find it. See if I can trigger it. I really want to like get that to where I can do like this, and it'll do it. That'd be a great trick. Good morning, everyone. It's good to see you all here this morning for worship on this day that I don't know about you, but I've needed this week as we come together for worship. And so as we have gathered, let us spend some time together in prayer. Holy God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Lord, as we have gathered in this place this morning, we trust that you have gathered with us. That as we have come into this place with confused minds, with heavy hearts, with the weight of bad news, Lord, some of us with the joy of good news, we trust, Lord, that you have come with the same things weighing on you as well. But we also trust, God, that you are God. You are our Lord, and you are the master of the universe. And so, therefore, God, we turn these things over to you in this time of worship, trusting that you will speak to us, that you will give us hope. You will bring us joy, remind us in the laughter we share, in the laughter we hear, and the songs that we sing, and this just time of being together, that you remind us of the hope and the joy that we have that is found only in you. So, Lord Jesus, be with us in this time as we worship. May our offerings of praise be pleasing to you, and may our ears, our hearts, our eyes, and our minds be open to receive whatever it is you have for us this day. In your name we pray. Amen.
So go to read this passage of Scripture. And actually, it works out. I didn't recognize when she told me the number, but it's from Psalm 82, and it's actually kind of one that I hold on to, especially when I'm traveling doing what I hope is the Lord's work as we prepare here to go to Greece again in a few weeks. But anyways, Psalm 82. God presides in the great assembly. He gives judgment among the gods. How long will you defend the unjust and show partiality to the wicked? Defend the cause of the weak and fatherless. Maintain the rights of the poor and oppressed. Rescue the weak and needy. Deliver them from the hand of the wicked. They know nothing. They understand nothing. They walk about in darkness. All the foundations of the earth are shaken. I said, you are gods. You are all sons of the Most High. But you will die like mere men. You will fall like every other ruler. Rise up, O God. Judge the earth, for all the nations are your inheritance.
Amen. Let's all stand as we take out our hymnal. Turn to page 470, one of my favorite hymns of the faith, Footsteps of Jesus. Let's all sing the first and the last verse, okay?
Sweetly, Lord, have we heard thee calling, come follow.
the last.
Then at last, when Almighty sees us, our journey done, we will rest where the steps of Jesus end at his throne. Footprints of Jesus that make the pathway come. We will follow the steps of Jesus where they go.
Amen. You may be seated as the children make their way up front.
Some more coming up too. Come on. All right. You want to sit by me, Caroline? Come sit by me. Oh, you see the goodies back there, don't you? Come on. Good morning, guys. It took us a little while to get down here, but I'm glad that we all made it. Okay.
Me and Hudson had a big one.
You and Hudson? Yeah. Okay. Well, what I wanted to talk to y'all today about is prayer. What kind of prayers do you do? Do you do prayers every day?
Yes.
What kind of prayers do you do, Levi?
I do God.
You do God? Okay. We, most of the time, what are some of the most important times that we pray each day?
Easter, Christmas.
Easter, Christmas, yes. Those are good times to pray, yes. What about when we eat? Do we say a prayer before we eat?
Yes.
Yeah, and we say prayers before we go to bed at night? Every Friday? That's good. That's good.
I said happy Friday.
Happy Friday. Okay. Okay. Well, is it easy to pray or is it hard to pray?
Hard.
Hard? You think it's
hard to
pray?
No, it's easy.
It's easy? Yeah. Levi, I bet you can say some good prayers. I can't wait to have you in class because I know we're going to get some good ones. Okay. So we've talked about it before, but a prayer that I wanted to go over again with us today is our five-finger prayer. How many fingers do you have?
Five.
Five. Yeah. Okay, can you hold your hands up? Can you hold your hand up? Caroline, hold your hand up. Okay, so this thumb finger, when we see our thumb, we want to remember that we pray for those that are closest to our heart. So who would that be? That would be like mom and dad, brothers and sisters, right? Okay, well this finger right here
is a one.
Is a one, yep. We also call it our pointer finger.
Index.
Okay. Anyway, this finger here.
Can I play a prayer, Bruce?
Yeah. Is used, when we see it, we want to think about the ones that are that lead us, like our teachers and people like that. So when we see that finger, we can think to pray for them. And then the tallest finger, we want to think of our government. And they really, right now, are playing a special part. We need to really pray for our government right now. Okay, and this one here is our ring finger. And it's for people that are sick. We need to pray for people that are really sick. And our pinky is used for ones that are sick. No, for us. For us. Our ring fingers are sick ones, and the pinky is one we need to pray for us. But I also thought of something different. Look, do we know what these are?
Are Skittles.
Skittles. Right. You know how many different colors of Skittles there are?
How?
How many? Red. There's five. Yes. Yeah, so every time we see a different color Skittle, we can think to pray for the same things that we just prayed for. So like this orange one. Here, get an orange one. You want an orange one? You want an orange one? You want to come get you a Skittle?
Give me a green one.
Okay, get an orange one. We'll just get an orange one right now. Here you go. Get an orange one. Can you get an orange one? Okay. When we see that one, we can remember to pray. You want one, Sierra? For our family. Yeah, go ahead and eat it. You can eat one. I'll eat one too. There you go. So we can pray for our family. Okay, so green. We'll see a green Skittle. Everybody want to get a green Skittle?
I don't know how much we get.
Get a green one. All right. We can pray for those that help lead us, like our teachers. Okay. Okay, now let's see what other color we got. Yellow. So get a yellow one. Yellow. You want a yellow? That's for our government. We help pray for our government. Purple will be for those that are sick. Because when you're sick, you really need the color purple, right? And red will be for yourself, to help pray for yourself. Aiden, you want some? Mm-mm. Okay. So it's very important that we remember to pray, and we pray for these people each and every day, okay? Okay, well, I'm going to say a prayer with us before we go. We don't have children's church today, but the threes and fours will. So if you're three and four, you'll still go up, but...
I'm
5, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11.
Yeah, we'll stay in church. Okay, so let's say a little prayer before we go. Dear Lord, thank you for those children that are here with us today. Help us to guide them down the footsteps that you would have them go. These things we ask in your name. Amen. And I also have little bags of Skittles for you. So you can get your own bag of Skittles. There we go.
Only one for my brother.
Okay.
Amen. Let's turn to hymn 461. Y'all can remain seated as we sing this great song. He leadeth me. What a blessed thought that is this morning, to know that He is leading us. Never mind. Yeah, bring it down. Let's say it.
He leadeth me, O blessed thought, O words with heavenly comfort brought. Whate'er I do, where'er I leave, still 'tis God's hand that leadeth me.
Let's all stand as we sing our offertory hymn for this morning, 452. What a great prayer this is for all of us. Make me a blessing. We'll do the first and the last verse. Let's sing it out.
Make me a blessing.
you join us, we pray. Awesome God, we come to you today. Lord, we know all good things come from you. Lord, we just ask that you forgive us for sometimes in our busy lives, we just forget the most important blessings. Lord, this beautiful world we live in that you spoke into existence. Lord, and that you sent your son, Jesus Christ, to die for our sins, to pay that awful price. And Lord, you gave us your written word, inspired written word, Lord, to lead and guide us and give us direction. You sent your Holy Spirit when your son ascended to sit by you and still intercede on our behalf. Lord, forgive us when we fail to give thanks for these. And as we come to this part of the service, Lord, we just pray that as we return a portion of that to you that you've blessed us with, it, we do it with thankful and cheerful hearts. And Lord, we ask that you guide us in the way we use it, and it would be used in a way that would uplift your name and bring honor and glory to you. I ask this prayer in Christ's name. Amen.
felt like a very grand way to walk into the pulpit. Man, I like that. Need the fog machine next time. That was awesome. Thank y'all. Well, this morning, I invite you to turn with me in your copy of God's Word to the 10th chapter of Luke's Gospel. And as you turn there, don't think I've forgotten. The Lord be with you. Luke chapter 10, we're going to begin with verse 25. Excuse me. Read through verse 37. Just then, a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he said, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" He said to him, "What's written in the law? What do you read there?" He answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind and your neighbor as yourself." And he said to him, "You've given the right answer. Do this and you will live." But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "Man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, 'Take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend.' Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers?" He said, "The one who showed him mercy." And Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." May God bless the reading and hearing of Holy Scripture. Would you pray with me? And now, O Christ, may you give us ears to hear, eyes to see, hands and feet to go and do what you call us to do, that we may be the people you call us to be. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. So what do we call this story from Jesus? The parable of the Good Samaritan. But I want to offer to you this morning that I don't think that's the right title. I don't. At least not this morning. There may come a time years down the road when I read this and argue the other way. But this morning, I just don't think it's the right title. And mostly because of the context in which the story is told. Luke tells us that a lawyer, now this isn't the kind that have billboards all up and down the highway. This isn't an ancient Alexander Shinara or a Jerusalem hammer or anything like that. A lawyer was a man who was an expert in both the civil law, but also, more importantly, and in this case, the Mosaic law, the law of Moses. And he stood up, and the NRSV says, to test Jesus. Your Bible may say to tempt Jesus, but the word there really is better understood as to entrap him, to snare Jesus. He doesn't care what his answer is. He wants to catch him. And so he asked Jesus a question that others have asked him. What must I do to inherit eternal life? Now, another man one time came and asked Jesus the same question. When we put the different tellings together, we call him the rich young ruler. He came to Jesus. What must I do? And Jesus said, what's in the commandments? He said, this. I kept them since I was a kid. And Jesus says, okay, one thing you lack, go sell everything you have, give the money to the poor, and come and follow me. And maybe this lawyer had heard him say that, and maybe he was expecting him to repeat it. Maybe he expected him to say something different. I don't know. But the fact is, he wanted to catch him. But Jesus actually doesn't answer him, but instead says, "Well, you, Mr. Big Shot, you're the one with the degrees on the wall. You're the lawyer. You tell me. You read the Bible. You've read the law. What's written in there? How do you read it?" And do you notice what he says? Love God. Now, that's part of the Shema. He's heard that at least twice that day. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind. That covers pretty much everything. I can't think of anything left out. And if you can, it's because you're looking for it. There's nothing. Love God with everything. And he says, he adds this bit from the 19th chapter of Leviticus, your neighbor as yourself. I'm pretty sure you've heard me say that before. But what happens next? This is amazing to me. Jesus says to him, "You have given the right answer." Y'all, that never happens. Never. Not even the disciples, right? You remember there's a story in the Gospels where Peter comes to Jesus and he says, "How many times should I forgive my neighbor? 7 times? And he says that in such a way as to where it sounds like it's really big, because the rabbi said just 3 and that's it. And Peter says, 7 times? And Jesus says, "No, you dummy." That's my translation. 7 times 70. It never happens. No, it never does Jesus say, "You got it right," except right here. "You have given the right answer. Do this and you will live." That should be the end. That should really be the end, not only of this passage, of this story, but this should, in many ways, I think, should be the end of all of our questioning at times. This should be, if there's a bumper sticker for our faith, if there's a needlepoint hanging on the wall, if there's a motivational poster in our office, it ought to be that. Love God and your neighbor as yourself, and that's it, right? In fact, I heard a man tell me one time, way wiser than I am. He said, "If you could just take that passage, love God and your neighbor as yourself, and just have that one and keep it in your shirt pocket, and then just live it every day, the rest will kind of fall into place." I think that's wise. So should we have the invitation now and move on? But this man doesn't. Did you notice that? What does Luke tell us he wants to do? Wanting to justify himself. Oh, man, that's where it gets us, isn't it? Jesus says, it's simple, folks. Love God and each other. But, Jesus, what about? He wants to justify himself. So he asked Jesus, okay, I'll get the loving God part. I go to temple. I show up. I give my sacrifices. I'm a lawyer. I read the scriptures. I know them. I pray. I don't do anything on the Sabbath I'm not supposed to do. I get it. I got the love God part down. But who is my neighbor? You know, I get the feeling he reached in his pocket, grabbed his pen, had a little pad, said, "All right, Jesus, tell me, who is it? Give me a list so I'll know. Because I want to do this. I want to do it right. Tell me, who is my neighbor?" He wants to justify himself. Give me a list. Give me some description who it is. And we want that not so we can love them. You know that, right? We do that so we can know who not to love. Who to keep off the list, who we don't have to love, who we don't have to extend grace to. That's why he asked the question. That's why I ask it. That's why we all do. But I love Jesus' response. And maybe I'm taking a little too much poetic license, but you notice Jesus doesn't start this parable with once upon a time, or let's suppose. No, he says a man. I like to think there ought to be a big comma right. Who is my neighbor? A man, a person, was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho. And that's literal, by the way. You go down. It's a road about 17 miles long. And from Jerusalem to Jericho, it falls 3,300 feet. It's pretty steep. There's some narrow places. There's some places where shrubs grow. There's some wide open spaces where nobody's built a house. There ain't even a McDonald's. There's nothing on that road for 17 miles. And he fell into the hands of robbers who stripped him and beat him and went away, leaving him half dead. You know, that catches me for some reason, that half dead part. Because I don't know how you measure if somebody's half dead or if they're half alive. But you know what it makes me think of? It's odd at first, but follow me, hear me out. When I was a kid, I lived, you know, on the weekends out at Dad's place, and sometimes you get a stray dog. None of y'all have this happen, right? Stray dog comes up in the yard, eating all your dog's food or scratching up stuff. We had a dog come up, I'm not kidding y'all, ate the wiring harness out of my stepmom's car. And I remember the old timers would say, you know what you do? You take that dog and you put him in the back of the truck and you drive over a bridge, drive across a creek, drive across water and leave it and come home. Now, I guess that worked. I don't know. But they said it in such a way as they didn't care if the dog wandered off in the woods and got bit by a snake, or if the dog wandered up in somebody's yard, got gravy trained twice a day, got to sleep on the bed, and had the best time of its life. They didn't care. It is the sort of like epitome of not caring. That's what I think about. Left him half dead. Didn't care enough to kill him. Didn't care enough to just tell him, all right, now look, we're going to take your wallet, take all your valuables, you just turn around, you didn't see us, we'll walk away slowly, don't you say anything to the cops. No, they left him. As if it didn't matter. If he's dead or alive, don't care, just throw him off. There he is, this man. Now you notice too, Jesus doesn't say a Jewish man on the road from Jerusalem to Jericho. Do you notice he doesn't say a Gentile man on the road from Jerusalem? He doesn't even get to the end of the parable and say a Samaritan man. No, he says a man. And I think he does that for a very important reason. Here he is wandering around in the Galilee teaching. Here's some Jewish folks listening. He can say a man, and all of them look, all of a sudden they picture themselves, their brother, their cousin, somebody who looks like them, talks like them, thinks like them, shares supper with them. Or Luke's audience reads it. A bunch of Gentile converts, a bunch of Greeks, Romans, all sitting around. A man, that could be me. Or here we are, Williams, Alabama. A man, that could be me, that could be you. If we take the gender out of the language that's inherent in most languages except for English, we can say a person, they could be anybody. And here they are, left, half dead. Now by chance, Jesus says, a priest came walking by. That's interesting. By chance. That's kind of a phrase that suggests like, ooh, as luck would have it, a priest came by. As if God had seen the thing that happened and sent someone. By chance, a priest came by. But he was on the other side of the road, and so he walked. Wait, that's not how the parable goes. Jesus is intentional. Do you notice that he says, by chance the priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. Think about that. It's not that the man was beaten and thrown in the ditch on the right side of the road, and when the priest comes by, he's over on the left side, didn't see him. He saw him. He saw the man, and then intentionally went around him to get out of the way. He saw the problem, but didn't want to do anything about it. Now, some people have come to the priest's defense. They say, well, you know, he's a priest. He's on the road to Jericho, or maybe on the way back to Jerusalem, there at the temple. He's got to be there. He has to be at the temple to make those sacrifices, to intercede on behalf of the people and on behalf of God. He's got to be there. Some of them say, well, the priest, you know, he couldn't touch him because he might have been dead. And if he touched a dead body, he'd be unclean and he couldn't perform his priestly duties. I want to tell you something, and I hope you hear me for what I'm about to say. I honestly believe, I'm convicted of this, God would rather have that priest in the ditch with a nearly dead man than sitting there in the religious temple doing the work of religion. And I think the same is true for us. Now, here's the other thing. He's not by himself. Here's the priest, the man who, you know, wears the vestments, the big turban on his head. He's there offering the sacrifices in the temple. But who else comes by? A Levite. Or Levi, that'd be something, wouldn't it, if Levi came by? He might help. I'm sure Levi would help, actually. That'd be a better story, I think, now that I tell it. But a Levite comes by. We're a little fuzzy on Levites. They were the chosen tribe by God, out of whom came the priestly class and these things. But by the first century, Levites, think of them as like the chairman of deacons. Uh-oh, Wendell. Like the chairman of deacons. Or like seminary professors. Laymen with a lot of education, a lot of training, a lot of calling placed on them. They may not be in the priestly class or in the priestly office, but they're important. So here comes a Levite. By chance. Good. We read the story. Let's not skip to the end. Maybe a Levite will help them. Because you know them preachers. You know how they are. They got to be somewhere. They got to do something. They got committee meetings going on. But not the lay folks. Not a Levite. But Jesus says the same thing. When he saw him, when he came to the place and saw him, he passed by on the other side. He saw him. The priest and the Levite, they see the man. They see the problem. They see the man who is beaten and left half dead, and then make the decision to pass by on the other side. Now, some folks have come to the Levite's defense, say, well, he might have been going to Jericho to visit somebody. Somebody might have been in the hospital. Somebody might have died. But again, I feel like God would rather have him in the ditch than they are making small talk with someone in the hospital. So here he is. Priest and a Levite, they pass by this man. Now, usually when the rabbis told stories like this, they'd say, okay, well, here's one you'd expect would do it. Here's another you'd expect to do it. But don't worry, the third person, it's you. They tell that story and say, okay, the priest didn't do it. The Levite didn't do it. But don't worry, here comes a good Israelite. Here comes a good Jew. He'll take care of it. That's what they're expecting, right? They're all sitting there on the edge of their seats, worried about this nearly dead man. And I can hear the priests and the Levites. I can even hear some of the people in the crowds talking about that man. You know, if he hadn't been on that road, he might not have got beaten. Everybody knows the road from Jerusalem to Jericho. That's dangerous. You shouldn't travel it alone. If he hadn't been by himself, this wouldn't have happened. Maybe he was walking around with a gold chain around his neck, big old, you know, watch or something on it, and they saw it, and that's why they jumped him. That's why they mugged him. It's his fault. I can hear him. I hear him because I hear it all the time. Like I told the folks in Sunday school, I wish I could remember who said it now. It really changed the way I read it. They said, imagine if this wasn't a man but a woman stripped and beaten on the side of the road. There's a lot more going on than just someone being mugged. I could hear him. If he hadn't been there, it wouldn't happen. Can't blame the priest and the Levite. They walk past. And now the next obvious step in the story is supposed to be an Israelite. It's as if we were telling the story, well, the pastor and the deacon went by, but don't worry, the Sunday church going person, they're going to save him. That's going to happen. He'll be there. But then Jesus says, a Samaritan. Now right there, I know what happened. They're all leaning in. Jesus is telling the story. A priest goes by, a Levite goes by. But a Samaritan. Pfft. And they walk off. They don't want to hear that noise. A Samaritan? No. What happens? Does a Samaritan go by and kick him? That's what they'll do, you know. A Samaritan will go by and spit on him. Samaritan? No, no. What are you talking about? A Samaritan. Now we've got it in our minds that the Jews don't like the Samaritans because they're foreigners, because they're not quite Jewish. No, they don't like them because they see them as an abomination. Samaritans were the descendants of Assyrians and Jews, or Israelites. In 722, when Assyria came in, conquered the northern kingdom, spread them all over the world, all over the known world at the time, some of them stayed, and they married the Assyrians. And they had children. And they set up a temple in Samaria and said, if the Jews won't let us come to Jerusalem, we'll set up God in our temple here in Samaria. And the Jews said, you are all abominations. Every breath you take is a sin. You can't be. You can't come near us. They didn't want to fool with them. Didn't want to trade with them. Didn't even want to pass through their territory on the way to go somewhere else. So when Jesus says, a Samaritan, this isn't just saying like a Mexican. This is something much more. An abomination? A Samaritan? Jesus says a Samaritan while traveling. He's not just passing by. He's on his way to somewhere. He's in the middle of life. If anybody has an excuse not to stop, it's him. He's got the van loaded down. He's traveling on the interstate and there's someone broken down and he's in the far left lane. He can't slow down. He can't stop. He's on his way to somewhere. While traveling by, came near him. And notice what Jesus says. When he saw him, he didn't stumble on him. He saw him. He was moved with pity. Moved with compassion. So he went to him. And Jesus says he bandaged his wounds, poured oil and wine on them, put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, took care of him for the night. The next day gave 2 denarii, 2 days' wages, to the innkeeper and said, guess what? When I come back, if you pay anything else, I'll pay that too. And we all say, that's a great thing. But understand really what's happening. The road from Jerusalem to Jericho, notorious for bandits and robbers. Here's a man beaten and left half dead. Here's a Samaritan who stops with his animal, with his oil, with his wine, with his money clinging in his pockets. He's taking a risk. This is dangerous. This isn't just, oh, this is a nice thing to do. This is dangerous. How many of you, I know a lot of us drive to Atlanta sometimes. When you get off of I-20, you're going on that 75, 85 to get on, and you know, it's always backed up. It's never moving really right. There's always people there, got buckets, maybe a cardboard sign asking for some money. What do we do? What do we do sometimes? And I say we because I do it. What do? If you got your window down, what do? You roll it up. You make sure the doors are locked. And you look the other way. Because you think it's dangerous. We've been told to think it's dangerous. We don't want to have anything to do with that. And here's this Samaritan. Here he is. It's dangerous. He might as well be rolling through the most dangerous part of town in a nice Mercedes and stops to get out to help the man who's beaten. Jesus doesn't just say, and the Samaritan stopped to help him. He goes out of his way to say, look, he takes the risk. He crosses the boundaries. It's not just his own kind helping his own kind. It's dangerous. And so he asked the man who asked him the question, which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? Do you remember the man's original question? Back in verse 25. What must I do to inherit eternal life? And now here we are. Jesus has come back and says, all right, which one of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man? And he can't even say it. Did you notice that? He can't even say it. It's easy answer, right? If you or I were asked that question, what would we say? Which one of the three, the priest, the Levite, or the Samaritan? What would we say? The Samaritan. But he can't even say it. It's filthy in his mouth. The one who showed him mercy. That's what he says. The one who showed him mercy. Which really is more telling than I think he knows. The Samaritan. And so Jesus says to him, what must I do to inherit eternal life? That's his question. Love God, love your neighbor. Who's my neighbor? Doesn't matter. You are to be a neighbor. So you want to inherit eternal life? Go and do likewise. Did you notice that? I always think it's interesting when people ask Jesus that question. He never says, pray the sinner's prayer. He never says, ask me into your heart. He never says, be baptized. He never says any of the things that we as a church, and I mean the capital C church, have made into prerequisites for being a part of the body of Christ. He always says, come and follow me. Love God, love your neighbor as yourself. It's pretty simple, straightforward. There it is. Go and do likewise. Now, I have to tell you something. Over these last few weeks, as I've turned on my television, as I've logged on to social media, as I've picked up newspapers, or as I've just talked to people, it's been pretty discouraging. It's been heartbreaking to see the things that happen, to see the way people respond to them, and then to know that it's not in one direction or another. That it's not a clear line down the middle and everybody on this side is right and everybody on this side is wrong. There's just so much going on. And it leaves me every time. I've got to where I just don't want to hear about it. Because I ask myself, what can I do? And I'm so discouraged by the answer sometimes. It feels like I can do nothing. Whether it's shootings, whether it's mass shootings, whether it's millions of people displaced in refugee camps, whether it's whatever, whether it's children being hurt by teachers and their parents, I don't know what to do. I ask myself, what can I do? I'm sure not going to run for office, because let me tell you something. And this is free advice, and so it's worth what it take it for what it's worth. Politicians and politics are never going to solve anything. And that's about as political as this Baptist is going to get in the pulpit. So you can vote, you can tell me you can vote for somebody and this person's better than this person. I don't care. Jesus is better than all of them. But here's the truth. Here's the truth. What can I do? What can you do? What can we do? Jesus tells us, go and do likewise. That's the answer to it. It doesn't start by trying to solve the world's problems all at once. It starts by when we see something, we do something. When we know there is injustice in our own communities, in our own lives, we do something. When we know there's someone in need, we provide for them. We don't ask questions. We don't draw the lines. We don't say, who is my neighbor? We just be neighbors. We go and do likewise. That is the only way it's going to change. And we can say that, well, it won't change unless we pray. It won't change unless we do this. And all that's fine and all that's good, and I don't doubt that. But you know, there's a little forgotten verse sometimes in the book of James. Faith without works. What's the rest of that? Is dead. Or as my grandma would say, deader than a hammer. It's dead. Go and do likewise, Jesus said. That's our call. That's my invitation to you this morning. Go and do likewise. And if there's anything in your heart and your mind, something that prevents you from doing likewise to any single person, no matter who they are, today is the day to give it up. Today's the day to say, I'm done with that. I'm not going to be that way. Now, it'll slip back in. It will. There'll be times where you'll roll the window up and lock the doors. There'll be times when you'll say, if they hadn't have been there, if they had only done this, it's going to happen. But today is the day when you make a conscious effort to say, I'm not going to be that person anymore. I'm not going to draw the lines around people. That I'm going to do what Christ has called me to do. If you're going to confess him, you might as well do what he calls you to do. To go and do likewise. To be the people that Christ calls us to be. Neighbors to one another, to every single person in this world. May we all go and do likewise. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on us. Have mercy, Lord, when it's so easy for us to make excuses, point fingers, and place blame. Have mercy on us, Lord, when we fail to act on the problems we see, to help those we know need help, to love everybody. Lord, you've proven in the cross, you've proven in your resurrection that all of your people are worthy of love. So God, help us. Help us to be the people we claim and you call us to be. Help us to go and do likewise. Just as the Samaritan in your parable. Help us, Lord, to take those risks, to put our lives even in the way, even to the point of death. For that is what you have done for us. So Holy Spirit, move in our presence. Release us from whatever may be holding us back from showing your love to each and every person in this world. Help us to lay it down in this place, to give it over to you, and to never take it up again. Be with us now, Christ Jesus, we pray in your name. Amen.
Let's stand, 366. I surrender all.
May you love God with all that you have. May you love your neighbor as you love yourself. And as you go out from this place, hear the words of the Samaritan, the words of the story that Christ shared with us, and may you go and do likewise. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, go with us from this place, renewed by your Spirit, listening for your calling, looking, Lord, with your eyes to see the ways that we can be your hands and feet to love our neighbor as ourselves. In Christ's name, amen.